It is a blessing to have our chancel choir back as they have begun to practice again, and I'm going to step aside. So we appreciate their blessing us again. Glad to have them back in worship. Welcome to our services this morning here at New Hopewell. If you're joining with us online, we welcome you to our online services. Just a few announcements. There will be a wedding shower for Haley Moore and Brent Kaufman. Haley is the daughter of Julie Crenshaw, and that will be next Saturday, October the 8th, from 3 to 5 p.m. here in our fellowship hall. And John and Julie and Elaine are here with us, and so proud family, and just won't be too long to the wedding, right? I think it's the first weekend of November, because I couldn't be there to do that because I have state band competition, so unfortunately, but we are grateful for their forthcoming marriage, and if everyone is welcome to the wedding shower this week. I actually told my wife about this to remind her about it, and I said, John and Julie are having a baby shower, and she said, John and Julie are having a baby. I said, I meant Haley's having a wedding shower. Yes. she told me to get it straight for today's service, so I did, but it still was comical. Anyway, also, next Sunday afternoon, there'll be a baby shower in honor of Patrick and Edith and baby girl Burns. And just to begin with a joy, last week we asked for prayer for Edith and the little baby girl, because there was some questions about the possible need for the little child, but she is fine. The report was good, so we are very, very grateful that the high-risk pregnancy tests and all that came out extremely well. So we are grateful for that. So the baby shower for baby girl Burns will be next Sunday afternoon from 2 to 3 p.m. in the fellowship hall. And Patrick and Edith are registered at Amazon. And for our wedding shower, Haley and Brent are registered at Amazon and Bed Bath & Beyond. So you can see that in your announcements in our bulletin. And we're just getting to that time where college students are going to be in need. I did campus ministry for a long time. And right after fall break, they begin to get real hungry. So we're trying to help them out. If you'd like to be a part of our ministry to our college students, we're collecting $10 and $20 Walmart gift cards, and there is a basket out front on our little coffee bar out there. If you'd like to donate that, we'll be sending them a card and trying to get in touch with them and to express our continued prayers for them as they journey through college in that exciting time. All right. We will have our prayer request just a little bit. Thank you, Mr. Robert. One other announcement I want to make. There will be no regular programming during the week of fall break. So our teachers are happy that they get a little relaxation. And many of our families are traveling right now, and we pray for their safe return. Hope they have a joyful time during this fall break. Again, thank you for being here this morning. Thank you. this morning as we will celebrate communion. As we do the first Sunday of each month, we do so gratefully with an invitation to all people. I'll remind you again, that you do not have to be a member of this congregation or even a professing Christian to celebrate communion within the confines of this church. We believe that God's grace is for all people, and that indeed some of the first experiences of grace for many of us who grew up in the former Methodist tradition were the invitation to the table. So we invite all persons to the table, and we begin our celebration of worship this morning through liturgy with our call to worship, which will be our invitation to the Lord's table. Hear these words of invitation. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Let us confess together in the words around us. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn to thee, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As we continue with worship, let us stand and join our voices as we sing, Christ the Lord is risen today. We will sing selected verses. If you're following along in 302 in your hymnal, 1, 2, 4, and 6. Let us sing.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Earth and heaven in chorus say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, Alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, Alleluia. Love's redeeming work is done, Alleluia. For the fight, the battle won, Alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise, Alleluia. Christ has opened paradise, Alleluia. Soar we now where Christ has led, Alleluia. Following our exalted head, Alleluia. Made like him we rise, Alleluia.
I invite you to remain standing for our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, and the Gloria Patria to follow. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated as you're doing so. Children, come on down for the children's blessing.
As the children come forward, I do remind you, I failed to do this again, if you would please register your attendance by scanning the QR code or registering in our little black pew pad. We'd appreciate it. All right, we're miles apart over here, aren't we? Huh? Y'all doing good? Let me ask you a question. Did you ever get an opportunity to go spend the night with somebody else? Yeah? So maybe with your grandparents, or maybe with a cousin or something like that, or a great-grandparent. Did you ever get to go spend the night with a friend at a friend's house? Yeah, yeah. Now, I used to do that when I was little, and my parents were very strict about that. And they would tell me, you better be on your best behavior. And they also give me a rule, a very important rule for my parents. Don't put your feet on their furniture. Anybody ever hear that? Just in case they don't let you do that. Some families do, some families don't. Anyway, I remember getting those strict rules, and it was kind of almost like they were threatening me. I better be good while I was gone. Because they knew other people in their homes that might have different rules than we have in our house. Might be a little different. So they wanted me to be on my best behavior so I wouldn't get in trouble, right? And our story today in our sermon is going to be the story again from the parable of the prodigal son. And you remember that story? He was, we call him the prodigal. He went as far away from home as he could, and he was upset with his family, we believe, and he left, and then he lost all of his money. He had nothing to eat, and he wanted to eat what pigs eat. He wanted to eat pig slop. Can you imagine? Ooh. But then he decided maybe he could go home to his dad, and maybe his dad would forgive him, and his dad would make him like a hired worker and give him at least something to eat. Well, then when he got home, his dad was so excited to see him. His dad saw him at a distance, and he ran to him and embraced him in his arms and put new clothes on him, and they had a great big party of the best foods. He came back into his father's house, and instead of doing what he wanted to do, he decided to do what his father wanted him to do, and his father threw a great big celebration, right? So when we believe in God, sometimes he asks us to do things that may be different than what we want to do. They may be different than what we want, but when we come into God's house, when we come into a relationship with God, he has rules for us that give us life and celebrate and make us happy, right? And give us energy. Y'all ever had energy? Yeah. So remember, when you come to know God, when you come into his house, which is kind of a symbol, a sign that we grow closer to him, that sometimes he's going to ask you to do things that might be a challenge for you, that might be things that you don't want to do, not in the sense because they're bad, but in the sense because it changes maybe the way you want to act and makes you even better. God will challenge us. But when we do, He gives us a joy in our heart and a celebration that is better than any celebration at all, doing what God wants us to do. Okay? All right? Y'all ready to pray? All right, let's pray. Father God, I thank You for the children of this church, for all Your children in this community, in the world, and in Your kingdom. And Father, I pray that You would bless each one gathered here, that they would know Your joy, the joy of serving You and coming into Your home, into a deep relationship with You to bring You happiness and for them to be filled with happiness and joy and celebration. Bless them that they may always so celebrate in their life. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can go back to your parents or to children's church, wherever they direct you. Of prayer. Thank you, Cameron. I'll go back to my lapel just when I start to preach. Thank you, buddy. As we turn our attention to our time of prayer, we do want to remember Joni Gamble. Joni, our PDO director, did have surgery this week for breast cancer, and I believe yesterday finally her pain began to ease, and so we want to continue to pray for Joni and her husband, Todd. We also want to pray for Nikki Lewis, which I believe Nikki is Bill Tate's mother. Is that the right Nikki? That is Miss Nikki, who is suffering from aging disabilities, and we want to pray for her. Also, Robin McKnight, who has colon cancer and is undergoing 5 days of treatment, I believe each week, and so she's has good and bad days. Allison tells us we want to continue to pray for her. I want to continue to pray for Michael Graves, as we mentioned last week, as he will be, as he has been diagnosed with cancer for the second time, grew up within this church. I want to continue to pray for him. Scott Hubble, one of our usual early service church attendees, he had shoulder surgery also on Thursday, and said other than not being able to find a way to rest very comfortably, he's doing well. We also want to see added to our prayer list is Anderson Massey and Harper Wiley. We want to pray for them and continue and begin to lift them up in our prayers. Also, failed to mention this in the first service, but I remember it now, that Jeremiah's middle son, right, Si, who wants to be an aviator, is going for his flight test tomorrow for his first license. So Si, we want to remember in our prayers as he has plans of being a pilot for his life. So I believe he's at MTSU. Is that where he attends? So they have the flight training there. We want to pray for Si tomorrow as he did pass his written test, right? Oral test, so that's good. So we want to pray for him as he'll be in the air tomorrow. And we do want to pray for the family. Let me get it straight. Warren Paul Cagle, Bonnie Cagle's son, his in-laws lost everything in the hurricane this week. So we will be, if you'd like to make a donation, we'll be trying to help them out some. But they did lose everything during the hurricane. And we want to pray for many who were overwhelmed with destruction this last week. And very powerful Hurricane Ian has gone not only through Florida but up the East Coast. Pray for all those dealing with flooding. Was there a prayer request, Mr. Robert?
Well, then our daughter is going to drive down to the Senate for 3 days, and she'll be driving about 7-8 hours each
way. Sure. We'll remember Virginia. All right. We'll pray for Virginia this week. And also, Mr. Robert will be going for some testing tomorrow, having some neurological problems. So we want to pray for him as he'll be having exams tomorrow morning. All right. If there are no other prayer requests, let's bow for our morning prayer to be followed by the Lord's Prayer. Prayed in unison. Father, how wonderful it is to gather before you, knowing indeed there is power in the blood. Power as we have come confessing our shared sin. Lord, to know that you continue to pour upon us, to lavish upon us your grace. How grateful we are for that grace, a grace that heals us in our times of woundedness, both physically and spiritually. Lord, we thank you for that. And indeed, we pray for our loved ones who are battling against cancer. Lord, we pray that you would touch and heal them and make them well for Robin and Joni and Michael, that you would nurture them in every way. And Father, we pray for those like Miss Nikki and others who are suffering from aging disabilities, those in hospitals and memory care units, Lord, those who give care to them, their doctors and nurses, give them patience, give them healing, and give them strength. And Father, we pray for those who are recovering from surgery, both like Scott and Joni and many others that we know. We pray that you would continue to touch and heal and strengthen them, Lord. And Father, we pray for all those who are battling against any common diseases, those who have been stricken with COVID in recent weeks, Lord, and all the ongoing illnesses of the fall season. May your healing and blessing be upon them. And Father, we do pray your healing and your safety would be upon all those who are traveling during this season of fall break. We do pray for Virginia that you would keep her safe. We pray for many who are scattered to and from, Lord. In a time of relaxation, please watch over them and all the people who travel, Lord. And Father, we ask your blessings upon our church members who are engaging in a great celebration this week of the state golf tournament. We pray, Lord, for Carly and Olivia and our friend Dale as he coaches. Bless them, we pray, that they would know your safety and that in all things they would bring you honor and glory and praise. And Father, we, as we worship you today, as we come before your table, Father, we pray that you would continue to transform us into your children, that we might more fully become your sons and daughters. And Lord, that indeed that your kingdom may come within our hearts and souls and lives and our very actions. And Lord, that our generosity may be spread to those in great need. Lord, for those who are in Florida and the Eastern Seaboard, we pray for your healing, that you would provide for them in every way. And Lord, we pray for Warren Paul's family. Lord, as they grieve the loss of material goods, Lord, we pray that they would be restored manyfold through your blessings of peace and strength. And for all those who have lost loved ones, all those who mourn and grieve during this season and every season, Lord, we pray that your peace that passes understanding would anoint, strengthen, and heal them. And Lord, we pray for this congregation and every congregation that gathers and every household represented in them, that indeed, Lord, we might receive your kingdom and that we might spread the truth and glory of your kingdom abroad. We pray for those who give care to us in our times of woundedness, our doctors and nurses, our paramedics and EMTs, our firefighters and police officers, and our armed service personnel. We pray for those who have been deployed to serve, Lord. Watch over them, anoint them, and Lord, be a shield of protection around them. And Lord, we pray for the leaders of this nation, President Biden, the leaders of Congress. We pray for those who are seeking election, that together they may lead us according to your will. And we pray for the leaders of both Ukraine and Russia, Lord, that this war may cease, that new times of healing may begin. Lord, that you may reign eternal in every moment. Lord, bless us, we pray, indeed, that your kingdom may come amongst us in this place, in this community, within this state, within this world, within every nation, that you may be glorified. We ask all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture lesson today should be familiar to you if you were here last week, and more than likely familiar to you in general, as we'll be reading again the parable of the prodigal son, and as it is termed now, the parable of the prodigal and his brother. So you can remain comfortable today. It's a rather long reading, so I invite you to remain seated as you feel your comfort. Please hear these words from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the wealth that will belong to me.' So he divided his assets between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant region, and there he squandered his wealth in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that region, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that region, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now, his elder son was in the field, and as he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he's got him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I've been working like a slave for you and have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back who has devoured your assets with prostitute, you killed a fatted calf for him?" The father said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." Thus endeth the reading, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come as the light and reveal. Come as the fire and burn. Come as the wind and cleanse. Convict, convert, consecrate until we are wholly thine. Amen. This morning, I want us to think again on God is good, the imagination of grace. It's hard for me to fathom the idea that there are people who exist that don't believe in God. I really am dumbfounded by that. I don't think I have ever had that thought in my life. Now, we've wrestled in the last few weeks with, at least briefly so, I mean, we could wrestle with the question of whether God is good or how do we reconcile God's goodness in suffering probably for the rest of our lives until we're able to ask God face to face and never get the answer that would calm all of our fears or anxieties. But I've never questioned the fact that God exists. It just seems like a question to me that's of no warrant. When I see the beauty of a sunrise or a sunset, wow, if that happened by chance, I wish I had that much chance to play the lottery with, right? Something incredible was afoot. By the way, I don't play the lottery, all right? There are people who are numerous within our culture who don't believe that God exists, and therefore they don't believe that Jesus is God, and so therefore they don't believe in the teachings of Jesus. And we're much worse off because of it, aren't we? When I read the parable of the prodigal son, and we won't do it again next week, I promise, okay? When I read it, there's such a profound beauty there. There's no way it came from a human source. It's impossible. Man's best attempts throughout all other religions pale in comparison to those some 20 verses in which Jesus speaks about God's character and human character. The pagan religions always saw God as dark and foreboding. The Greco-Roman gods found that gods to be very fickle. Gods could lust. Gods could be guilty of greed. They could require things of you that you did not deserve. They could be evil. But Jesus' picture from the parable of the prodigal son defies even the best imaginations who want to create God as in their own image, even the best images of man, pale in comparison to the image painted by Jesus in the parable of the prodigal son. Could I preach for weeks on end? Yes, on the parable. Do you want me to? No, and I won't do that to you, okay? I promise. It's a story that contains the profound beauty of a God who pursues us, a God that longs for us, a God whom we want to believe is going to exact upon us revenge for our wrongs, but we find that He'd rather embrace us and love us and offer us something different instead of hatred or judgment or vengeance. It also has the profound goodness which we see in our lives once we get to a certain age. You know, we're really good at seeing other people's faults. I got 20/20 fault vision, right? And most of us do. But when it comes to seeing our own faults, sometimes we can't see the forest for the trees, right? But in these few verses that we know as verses, these few words that Jesus teaches, He speaks a truth so profound that it reminds us that the one who has gone to desperate measures and lived a life of debauchery and sin really is fundamentally the same as the son who's obediently slaved for the father but has not yet really understand the true identity of the one who loves him, of his own father, whom we know in the parable as God. How do you put such profundity in such a small space? The only way you do that is if it's revealed by God. It's beautiful. To me, it's one of the greatest arguments that Jesus is God. No words have eclipsed it. And even to this day, our culture, as I've said before, recognizes the story of the prodigal as being profound. It finds its way in all kinds of media types. Even in a post-Christian culture, it reigns true. Why is that? Because it's an eternally true story. It came from God. Jesus is good. Jesus is God. He reveals great truth. I think it's erroneously attributed to Philip Yancey, who's quite a profound writer in the Christian faith in our modern era, or I guess what we, at least our brief lifespan. Anybody ever read Philip Yancey? If you haven't, I do encourage you to read the book, The Jesus I Never Knew. It's a really good book. But I believe it's sometimes miscredited to him, and I don't think he said it. I believe it was George MacDonald, the great 19th century theologian and preacher, who said, if Jesus had never lived, we could have never invented him. And I think if we take that logic on a little bit further, had the parable of the prodigal son never been revealed to us, we could have never invented it either. Because even the best parents on the best days tend to at times want to say, I told you so. And sometimes we get a little pleasure out of exacting a little punishment. We think God's that way, and apparently God's not. God's not. It's a beautiful story. But I wonder if it has piqued our imagination of grace. I want to thank Cameron for something I'm going to go ahead and confess. In the first service, I had the wrong peak up there. I had like a mountain peak. He said, Stephen, you had to misspell a word up there. I own that. I can't even spell cat most often, but he corrected that. So thank you, Cameron, for making me look good. So I humbly confess to you my faults, right? But I wonder if this story has truly piqued our imagination. Because if we're not careful, we make this story a story of God's cheap grace, to borrow a phrase from Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Because if we look at it on a very cursory level, we see this beautiful image of God who invites His fallen Son in despite His riotous, His dissolute living. It almost appears that God doesn't care that He's lived in a dissolute way. And that's not true. His Father does care because His Father knows that such a lifestyle is death. What does He say? We have brought Him, He's been brought back to life and must celebrate. There are things that God forbids. There are things that we might have a proclivity to within our life that might not be holy or wholesome or be God's design. That's true for all of us, not certain segments of society. All of us are fallen. Haven't we talked about that? All of us are fallen. All of us have a broken nature. That's what the elder son, the elder brother, reminds us. We too share in that prodigal brokenness. You remember the story, right? We just read it. We've read it twice, 2 weeks in a row. If you were here, I know you're happy. I can see the smiles on your face, right? The elder son had been out slaving obediently to his father. Well, what does he hear? He hears the sounds of music and dancing. Now, I didn't say this in the first service, but I'm going to share it with you because I love you so much in the second service, right? This proves the prodigal and his father are not Baptist. Because they were dancing, right? Baptists do dance, by the way. But this is right. Just a little levity I didn't get to put in the first service. He hears the sound of music and dancing, and he asks what has happened. When he realizes this warm welcome for his brother, he refuses to do what? He refuses the father's house. He doesn't understand grace. He doesn't understand God. His brother wants to believe there are things that can't be transformed. His brother is beyond transformation. He squandered your wealth. He lived with prostitutes. He has done the abominable. And he's forgiven? You're celebrating? What does the father say? He was dead and is now alive. In other words, what the older son doesn't realize is that God's grace is for the most broken, just as it is for him, the obedient. God's grace can transform all things, no matter how evil the sin has been. And this, Jeremiah asked me earlier, why do my sermons change from service to service? They're generally the same, but I continue to have light bulbs go off. I'm a Netflix guy. When I can stay up long enough, I watch Netflix. Right now, I'm about to go back to the deer hunting guy, meat eater, just to get my blood flowing for deer season. There's a documentary on Jeffrey Dahmer. Some of you are old enough to remember Jeffrey Dahmer. You know what Jeffrey Dahmer did? We know what he did in his great sin. But you know, before he died, he confessed faith in Jesus Christ. I've had people say there's no way God would ever forgive him. Oh, yes, there is a way. It's Jesus Christ. There is always a way through faith. That's God's business, right? The older brother didn't realize such transformation could happen. He didn't want to believe it. He didn't want to celebrate it. The younger son, however, come into the father's house where the older son refused to go. He had submitted humbly to his father's order, his father's reckoning of the world, his father's true identity. The older brother would not. The older brother had not recognized, just as sometimes we don't, God's grace, the Father's character is full of power. So we've been on this journey about 6 weeks now, 5 weeks of the sermon series. So help me out. I'm going to ask y'all to name all five previous sermons. I'm not going to do that to you. I couldn't do that either. All right? But I do know that I have made a general postulation that God is good. His work is therefore good, as we see expressed in the book of Genesis. We are a part of that good work. I said something that maybe didn't seem profound to you, but it is very much profound in the way we distinguish ourselves from others. We believe that our primary nature is good. It is fallen, but it is good. God does not hate us. God loves us. We are created in His image, and the process of salvation is to be transformed from that fallen, spoiled image into the image of Jesus Christ by the mercy of God. So God is good. His work is good. God is also powerful, right? So that means God's grace is what? Powerful. There is nothing that God's grace cannot transform. We're here today as New Hopewell Church because we believe God's grace is sufficient to transform every way in which we are flawed. Not so that you can be like me, not so that you can be like John Crenshaw or Robert Burns, but so you can be the person that God has designed you to be, fully a son or daughter of God that realizes God wants us to celebrate His goodness, His power, His grace. We all come the same way, broken. But we come to a power that is greater than all of our brokenness if we come to God's house, which is His presence, and say, Lord, we want Your mercy, and we need to celebrate it. As we come to the table this morning, isn't it really a celebration in some senses of everything that's broken? The worst brokenness of the world? Sin, death, and suffering? When we consecrate the elements, we'll remember the words of Jesus. We remember it's an opportunity to see proclaimed with a raising of the elements that God takes our brokenness and invites us to a new communion, to a new relationship, based not on our good works, based not on our failures, but based on His invitation to come into His presence and to celebrate the wonderful work of Jesus for us. This morning as we come, I invite you to in a moment, we'll respond with these words, the great thanksgiving. You can turn if you'd like, if you would see a little bit better on the in the print. You can turn to page 27, and we'll begin with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto Thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify Thy glorious name, evermore praising Thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of Thy glory. Glory be to Thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by the one offering of himself a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and didst institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father. We most humbly beseech thee and bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts of bread and wine, that we receiving them, according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his passion, death, and resurrection, may be partakers of the divine nature through him, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body broken for you, do this in remembrance of me. The body of Christ broken for you. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for the many. Do this as oft as you drink of it in remembrance of me. I'm going to invite the Crenshaw family to come up, and Allison's going to help me. So, Allison, the body of Christ broken for you. Julie, the body of Christ broken for you. John, the body of Christ broken for you. Allison, the blood of Christ shed for you. Julie, the blood of Christ shed for you. John, the blood of Christ shed for you. Again, as I mentioned earlier, everyone is invited to the Lord's table. Won't you come and experience the grace of God? Our hymn of invitation this morning will be this tried and true standard of many churches throughout the Americas, throughout the world, Victory in Jesus. Today, I invite you to come and celebrate the mercy and grace of Jesus, His victory for your life in any way that He's leading you. If it would be prayer again at the altar, if it's an opportunity to join this church in any way that we receive members, or perhaps you've never confessed faith in Jesus Christ and you would like to do so. Indeed, it is a way of victorious celebration through His kingdom. Won't you come?
Let us stand as you're able as we sing. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood atoning. Then I repented of
Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
May it be the grace that transforms our woundedness into his healing, that transforms our brokenness into his new life. May such grace undergird you. May it transform you. May it fill you up with joy, that indeed your life and the days to come may be a celebration of God's presence. And may you return here in his blessings of health and peace and the light of his Son, Jesus. Amen.